Okay, think of the last time that you gave blood. Or maybe you've had surgery, like you've had your tonsils or appendix removed. You know what happened to some of those things? The blood was tested, the tissue was biopsied, perhaps you had treatment. But what happened next? What did the hospital, doctors, or scientists do with your cells? If you think that material was destroyed, you might be right, but you might be wrong. In the United States, the 1990 court case, Moore versus the University of California, decided that as long as your tissue is anonymized, meaning your name and identification isn't associated with it, it can be used in research and science. You don't have to be informed or asked for consent. Once your cells are removed from your body, you no longer own them or have any say in what happens to them. Most of the time, this is no big deal. You weren't using those cells anyway. But in some situations, this ethical issue becomes a lot more complicated. Here's one example. In Sweden in 1962, a married mother of several children made the decision to end her pregnancy. After performing the abortion, without informing the woman or getting her consent, the fetal lung tissue was turned into a cell line, which is a group of reproducing cells from a single genetic source. Cell lines allow researchers to test the effects of different chemicals or treatments on cells while controlling for genetic variation. This one cell line has been used to successfully develop vaccines, including a rabies vaccine and a rubella vaccine ever since. Once the researchers realized how useful the cell line could be, they contacted the biological parents to obtain their medical history to ensure the cells were healthy. When the woman learned what had happened to the fetus, she was understandably upset that the cells had been used and experimented upon without her consent. Even in 2013, 51 years after the cells were first obtained, she's quoted saying, "They were doing this without my permission. This could not happen today." Ethically, many argue that saving hundreds of millions of lives is more important than what one person wants for cells she's chosen to remove. But what about the millions and millions of dollars in revenue generated by those vaccines? Without the cells, there'd be no vaccine, but there'd also be no profit. So does the donor deserve a piece of the pie? In this case, the woman just wanted to put the ordeal behind her. But in other cases, patients and their families argue that by using and selling their cells for profit without their consent, researchers are stealing from them. Henrietta Lacks, for example, died of cervical cancer in 1951, leaving behind 5 children and a tissue sample that may or may not have been removed without her consent. And this tissue was fascinating. When scientists fed the cells, they continued to reproduce outside of Henrietta's body, something scientists had never done before. They became the healer cell line. And today, healer products can sell for as much as $10,000 a vial. But because the tissue used to create healer cells was removed from Henrietta's body in the course of her medical treatment, legally they no longer belong to her or her family. So her relatives can't claim any of these profits. Few would argue that using these cells to develop treatments or medicines and save lives is a bad thing. But the ethical concerns are valid. Have researchers taken advantage of poor, sick, or vulnerable people for profit? Legally, this is allowed, but is it really okay? Would you want your cells used for science without your consent? And then if a pharmaceutical company made millions of dollars, would you feel entitled to some of the profit? As always, let me know what you think down in the comments. Hi, Luna. What you doing down there? Just being a big old sound blanket. That's what you do best.